Seven Secrets from Hindu Calendar Art by Devdutt Pattanaik. Chapter 6. Vishnu's Secret. Detached Engagement Brings Order. Part 1. This image here shows a cow, the most sacred animal in the Hindu faith. To kill a cow is the greatest sin a Hindu can commit, and eating beef is the greatest taboo. Cows are gentle creatures. They ask for nothing, but they give milk to man, which can be used to make curd, butter, whey, and sweets. Their dung becomes manure for the field, fuel for the kitchen, and plaster for the floors and walls of the house. When they die, their skin can be used to make accessories, and their bones can be used to make tools such as combs and buttons. Thus, it plays a critical role in satisfying man's need for food, clothing, and shelter. Naturally, cows come to have great economic significance. With a cow, a household could be sustained. The gift of a cow was a gift of life. Godan, or cow charity, was the greatest charity. It satisfied all worldly needs. Hindus believe that even the gods who live above the sky have a magical cow, called Kamadhenu, who can fulfill any wish and from whom all cows descend. Someone wondered, for whom does the cow produce milk? For her calf or for humans? How much milk can be taken by humans and how much should be left for the calf? All these questions expanded in scope and drew attention to man's relationship with the earth. Why did the earth exist? For all animals? Or was it just for humans? We alone, of all living creatures, have destroyed ecosystems for our own survival. We transformed forests into fields for our crops and pasture lands for our cows. We established farms and redirected rivers to our settlements. We broke mountains as we searched for metals and gems. We pierced the earth in search of water. And the earth bore it all, silently, like the cow. So emerged the notion of Gomata, the earth cow, sustainer of all creatures, the great container of life, as depicted in this image here. In the Bhagavat Puran, the earth explicitly takes the form of a cow and runs away when she feels she is being exploited by man. Vishnu begs her to forgive man, which she does, on the condition that man treat her with respect in the future. Vishnu promises that man will do so and takes on the role of her protector. He becomes Gopala, the caretaker of the earth cow. That is why Vishnu is called the preserver and the sustainer. As shown in this image here, Vishnu also enjoys the milk. He celebrates the bounty that nature bestows on man. Through this story of Vishnu, there is an acknowledgement that human society is an artificial construct, an unnatural phenomenon constructed by domesticating nature. The Vishnu principle ensures there is harmony between nature and culture. Society cannot exist at the cost of nature, for when nature is destroyed, nothing survives. But in nature, might is right. The strong dominate the weak. It is society and social rules that reverse this trend, making room for the helpless and meek. The more one is able to move away from the law of the jungle, the more dharma is upheld. The cow is not just nature or external material reality. It is also the mind or internal material reality. We want to be lions and dominate the world around us, but society forces us to be cows, to create value by producing milk and giving that milk not just to our calf, but to others as well. Society does not want us to be bulls like Shiva. Society castrates the bull and turns the bull into an ox with its rules and regulations so that we are fit to pull the cart burdened with demands and duties. Vishnu is Narayan in the woken state. This image shows him as visualized in a temple in South India. The image of Vishnu has to be contrasted with the image of Shiva. Shiva is associated with frozen water, snow. Vishnu is associated with the container of all water, the sea. The coiled hooded serpent rests around Shiva's neck. Vishnu stands on top of a similarly coiled hooded serpent. Shiva is smeared with ash, created by burning wood. Vishnu is smeared with sandal paste, created by soaking fragrant wood in water
and rubbing it against a stone. Shiva wears animal hide. Vishnu wears finely woven silk. Shiva wears a necklace of seeds. Vishnu wears a garland of flowers and is adorned with gems and gold. Shiva's sacred mark is horizontal, implying inertia. Vishnu's sacred mark is vertical, implying activity. Shiva sits still, with eyes shut and a serene face. Vishnu's eyes are open, he smiles, and he is ready to step into the world. Vishnu holds four tools in his hand. A conch shell that announces his presence. A discus that reminds us that life is constantly moving and all things that go around come around. A mace with which he strikes down those who break his law. And a lotus whose color, fragrance and sweet nectar are reward for those who uphold the law. Vishnu's law is born of a value system called dharma. Dharma is that which creates a stable society. On the one hand, it domesticates nature and tames the animal within man. On the other hand, it does not allow for the destruction of nature and is sensitive to the primal needs of man. The image on the left shows Vishnu with Lakshmi seated on a coiled serpent called Shesha, while the image on the right shows Vishnu and Lakshmi flying on a hawk called Garuda. Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth and power. She is the container of fortune. Vishnu never comes to her, she always goes to him. She is with him when he is still, represented by the hooded serpent, and when he is on the move, represented by the flying hawk. In other words, a stable and organized society generates wealth. Vishnu is the farmer, Lakshmi is the field. Vishnu is the leader, Lakshmi is his organization. One cannot exist without the other. This image also shows an owl sitting by the goddess's feet. This owl is said to be Lakshmi's sister, Alakshmi, the goddess of strife. When Lakshmi is worshipped, Alakshmi, her elder sister, is always acknowledged so that we never forget that with money come quarrels and fights, and we are prepared for it. Lakshmi follows Vishnu because Vishnu institutes and maintains dharma by overturning the law of the jungle. The jungle is based on the law of domination. The point is to survive, either through strength or cunning. But society is supposed to be based on the law of affection, where people care for and take care of each other. In the jungle, animals think only about themselves, their offspring or their herd, but in society, humans have the capacity to think beyond themselves and care for all humanity, and even for animals, plants, and minerals. As time passes, all societies change, values change. Society which begins in perfection moves towards imperfection, then collapses, and then is resurrected in perfection. Vishnu's discus is a reminder of the cyclical nature of things. The conch shell shows the unraveling of time. Air that passes through the conch shell gradually expands, creating sound, and then returns to primal silence. Thus, there is a rhythm in the world. The material world is changing, but with Vishnu, the change becomes cyclical, rhythmic, predictable. Vishnu thus manages the changes of time. He does not stop it. Shiva may shut his eyes to the goddess, but Vishnu's eyes are wide open and he smiles. For he understands the dance of matter and dances with her. Vishnu is called the Lord of Maya. Maya essentially means measurement. We constantly measure material reality and make judgments. Is it right or is it wrong? Is it good or is it bad? Is it expensive or is it cheap? The answer depends on the measurement scale. Vishnu is the source of all measurement scales. Hence, he decides what is beautiful and what is not, what is appropriate and what is not. All that is true and auspicious and beautiful according to his scale, he accepts. The rest is rejected. Vishnu's scale is based on one principle: love, caring, affection for the other. In other words, Vishnu turns away from the spontaneous law of the jungle based on domination and power. Vishnu also knows that all measurements are man-made and can change over time. Hence, all rules are flexible. That is why he knows culture and civilization are like a game, Leela. Fun if everyone upholds the rules and enjoys the participation. Games turn ugly when the rules are twisted and turned in our obsession to win. When winning is all that matters, then we turn into demons, asuras and rakshasas who celebrate the law of the jungle. Vishnu institutes and maintains dharma and adapts the laws according to the demands of history and geography by descending on earth as an avatar. This image here shows all the avatars. The first of these avatars, as shown here, is a fish or matsya. In this avatar, Manu, the first man, saves the small fish from the big fish by taking him out of the sea and placing him in a pot. This act of compassion creates society. The pot is the symbol of human society and is seen in the arms of Lakshmi in this image here. Later, the fish grows in size and keeps growing. Manu transfers the fish from the pot to a larger pot, then a pond, then a lake, a river, and finally a sea. The fish keeps growing until rains fall to make the sea large enough for the growing fish. So much rain falls that the earth gets submerged, and Manu, once the savior of the fish, finds his world getting destroyed. Why is this happening? Because the fish kept growing in size and Manu kept helping it, never realizing that it was time to stop, time to let the fish go and fend for itself. Thus, civilization starts when compassion begins. Civilization collapses when there is too much kindness and one doesn't know when to stop, when to draw the line. The fish ultimately saves Manu and teaches him this valuable lesson of human society. Vishnu then takes the form of a turtle or kurma, as shown in this image. He holds on his back a spindle that the devas and asuras use to churn the ocean of milk and draw out Lakshmi. Vishnu then takes the form of a woman, an enchantress called Mohini, and seduces the asuras, distracting them so that all the treasures that emerge from the ocean go to the devas. The furious asuras become the eternal enemies of the devas. They drag the earth under the sea, which Vishnu brings back as a boar or varaha, as seen in this image here. With Amrit, the nectar of immortality, obtained from the ocean of milk, the devas become immortal. Asuras yearn for Amrit. They demand various kinds of boons from Brahma, the creator, but each time Vishnu thwarts their attempts. This image shows Vishnu killing an asura who tried to make himself invulnerable by asking for a boon that he should not be killed by either a man or a beast. Vishnu attacked him in the form of a creature he had not conceived, one who was neither man nor beast, or perhaps both a man and beast. The story has been elaborated in chapter 2, Narayan's Secret, where the violent and gentle forms of Narsimha are depicted as shown in these images. Asuras who live under the earth get Sanjeevani Vidya from Shiva, which enables them to resurrect the dead. This makes them equal to the devas, who are immortal thanks to the Amrit. Vishnu then takes the form of a Brahmin boy, or Vaman, as shown in this image, and shoves the asuras under the earth, claiming the earth and the sky for the devas. Thus, though both are equally powerful, Vishnu gives them different spheres of influence. Asuras are below the earth, regenerating the wealth of the earth, minerals and plants, while devas are above, pulling out minerals and crops for the benefit of humankind. Thus, their conflict creates wealth. They are the force and counterforce of the cosmos, spinning the world around, churning it, thanks to Vishnu. Thus, tension and hierarchy are essential ingredients of the organization called civilization, established through dharma by Vishnu. Vishnu abandons the Brahmin form, as shown in this image, takes up an axe and becomes a warrior, striking down kings who use their position to exploit rather than serve society. This is Parshuram, Ram with an axe, who rose up when kings of the earth used their might to plunder the earth's resources. Parshuram kills a king who steals his father's cow. He even kills his own mother because she is attracted to a man other than his father. This story introduces us to the dangerous power of sexual desire and material desire. If not checked by rules of marriage and property, they can destroy civilization. The image on the top left introduces us to Vishnu as Ram, the ideal king, the one who sacrificed personal pleasure to uphold Dharma. The images on the bottom left and bottom right are of two brothers, Vishnu as Balram and Vishnu as Krishna. The former steps away from the world and renounces all rules. The latter participates in the world and keeps bending the rules. Balram is often equated with Buddha in many poster arts. They follow the hermit's ideal, much like Shiva, of stepping away from society because they are either fed up of the stranglehold of rules or have realized the artificial nature of rules that results in conflict and suffering. Ram and Krishna, on the other hand, engage with the world. Ram by upholding rules and Krishna by changing rules, both for the sake of Dharma. The image on the top right introduces us to Kalki, the last of Vishnu's avatars, the one who rides a horse and wields a sword, the one who will destroy the society that has become totally corrupt, no different from the jungle, so that the cycle of avatars will restart from the fish, as shown in the image in the center.
Jab chaho on ho jao, Epic on chalao, available across all devices.